Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure puts us back in the saddle. Not a saddle on a horse. The saddle on a 10-speed bike. Now, bike touring gives you a chance to kind of slow things down and see the sights along the way. Today, we'll be pedaling through the countryside along the bluffs of the Missouri River Valley here north of Vermilion. We'll be checking out the ecology and conservation techniques along the way. You know how much of South Dakota has changed since the early days of the frontier, but I know a spot that still nurtures the chest-high native prairie grasses that were so important to survival in those early days, but have since been plowed into fields of corn and soybeans.
The Indian people were a part of South Dakota's ecology for thousands of years before the settlers pushed the frontier to the west. Their way of life did little to damage the ecology of what was to later become South Dakota. Early Native Americans depended on nature to provide their food sources, and nature would replenish the soil and forest so other tribes could use the area too. Indians who lived by hunting and gathering plants moved often. They were nomadic, and they didn't impact the ecology of the area very much either. They followed the buffalo from one place to another. Usually they didn't kill more buffalo than they needed because they couldn't carry the meat and hides. And there were millions of buffalo and only thousands of Indians, so there was plenty to go around. In fact, the buffalo and elk herds were increasing right up to the time the fur traders pushed the frontier across South Dakota and started to kill buffalo faster than they could reproduce. Another thing to remember about the Indians' role in the ecology of South Dakota is that their religious beliefs centered around the concept that the animals and plants were sacred, which indeed they were as a key to their survival. When animals were killed for food, thanks would be offered to the spirits for giving life to the hunter and his people. And the way the Indians lived, with simple tools, living in relatively small numbers, meant they would have had very little impact on the environment. Believe it or not, fire has played a beneficial role in preserving our ecology. Fires destroyed the plants and animals they burned, but they also benefited the land. Prairie fires put richness into the soil from the ashes they left behind, and they made it easier for new plants to grow where old ones choked the soil. Nature has her own ways of taking care of the ecology, and sometimes her way is better than man's. In fact, we nearly lost the buffalo because of man's insensitivity to the ecology of the environment. Here's what happened. As the frontier pushed westward, trappers and traders made their way through the Dakotas in search of furs to dress the upper classes on the East Coast and in Europe. There were plenty of beaver to be made into hats and fur trim, but in their greed, the trappers took nearly every beaver in the state. And they probably would have, except that in the 1840s, the buffalo saved the beaver from extinction. All of a sudden, people wanted buffalo robes rather than beaver hats. The buffalo skin, with its tanned flesh on one side and thick winter wool hair on the other, was about the warmest thing in the world you could find. And remember that long before, the Indians had been using the hides as blankets, but they never abused the buffalo the way the traders did. The early fur traders did not worry about what would happen if large numbers of animals were killed for the fur trade. When the settlers and fur traders learned how to hunt American animals and how to trade with the Indians, animals like the buffalo and beaver were turned into a source of profit. Long before the settlers came to South Dakota, all the buffalo and most of the beaver had already been killed in the eastern United States.
There were always more animals further west. So when the animals disappeared from one area, well, the fur trade just moved on to the next place. And for that reason, the fur traders never gave much thought to the consequences of killing all the animals in South Dakota.
It wasn't until after the Civil War that the buffalo in the Midwest really began to feel pressure from hunters. Nobody knows how many buffalo were still living on the plains of the West in 1865. Perhaps as many as 35 million. and there were several million in South Dakota alone. In the late 1860s and 1870s, the buffalo runners killed millions of buffalo just for their hides. By 1890, there were so few buffalo left, many people feared they would become extinct. A number of factors combined to set the stage for the abuse of the buffalo in the West. For one thing, the hide was easier and cheaper to tan than other hides. Railroads and steamboats made shipping the hides easy. New rifles with cartridge shells rather than the old muzzle loaders made killing the buffalo easier. As the railroads came west, first they used buffalo to feed their construction crews. Then the railroads made it easier to get to the buffalo, and for a few hundred dollars, a man could get set up in the buffalo hide business. And then the army finally realized how important the buffalo was to the Indians' way of life and encouraged hunters to kill the buffalo as a means of controlling the Indians. Around the Black Hills, hunters like Buckskin Johnny Spaulding killed buffalo to sell to miners during the gold rush. With all these factors, by the early 1880s, it was hard to find a buffalo anywhere in South Dakota. Once, there had been millions. Thankfully, some people realized we had to save some buffalo and give them a range to run free. That way, future generations could get some idea of what it must have been like in the early days. Scotty Phillip was a man who cared about buffalo. He lived near Fort Pierre and salvaged the last of the South Dakota buffalo stock on his ranch. When you go to Custer State Park and watch the buffalo graze, you can thank Scotty Phillip for saving the herd. But not all the other animals in South Dakota found a guardian angel like the buffalo did. The wolf and the grizzly bear used to roam free in South Dakota until the hunters took all their work. And now both species are extinct in South Dakota. And that's not something we should be proud of.
If the pioneers had an impact on the animals, then they certainly had an effect on the land, plants, and water just as much. See, the pioneers thought about the land the same way the fur traders thought about the wildlife. They really weren't worried about saving the soil, or the prairie grasses, or the lakes, or the streams. They came to farm and to build new homes, and there was so much work to be done, and so little time to do it, that in the rush to get things done, little consideration was given to the impact on the environment. And besides, like the fur traders, it seemed there was so much land, we could never use it all up.
In the West River country, miners, loggers, and cattle ranchers saw things the same way. Miners were anxious to get as much gold as quickly as they could. After all, it was a gold rush. If the gold mines tore up some of the land and made streams muddy, well, that was just part of the price we had to pay for getting rich. Once the buffalo were nearly wiped out and the Indians all herded onto reservations, cattlemen moved in with thousands of head of cattle. Since the buffalo weren't grazing the prairies, it seemed like there would never be a shortage of pasture land. But we were growing out of control. And eventually, some people began to notice that changes in South Dakota's ecology weren't so favorable. Wildlife was getting scarce. Streams were muddy and polluted. Erosion was cutting into the Black Hills where the loggers had cut all the trees. And some mining techniques even encouraged the dumping of toxic chemicals into creeks. And as you may have guessed by now, the cattlemen overgrazed the prairies to the point that the lush native grasses were replaced by weeds. Since South Dakota was one of the last frontiers, people began to realize that we really could run out of land and that the West would not go on forever.
How can we solve those problems? Well, around the turn of the century, South Dakotans learned a new word, conservation. And with it came a whole new meaning of a way of looking at the ecology of South Dakota. See, ecology means we need to take a better look at the way we use our natural resources. We need to be more careful about the way we plan for the future in terms of our farming, ranching, mining, and logging operations. And it also means we should be careful not to waste any of our natural resources.
Early attempts to conserve South Dakota resources took many forms. We've already seen how some people tried to save the buffalo. Well, to protect more of our wildlife, the state legislature established the Department of Game, Fish, and Parks. And many South Dakotans were concerned about the forests in our state. You see, trees were being cut faster than they could grow back, and that leads to increased soil erosion. In 1897, the Black Hills National Forest became a part of the federal forest system. Now, the government could control how much wood was cut, and logging companies that owned forest land began to harvest timber more carefully so the forests would last. And South Dakota farmers became a part of the conservation movement. The pioneers learned that South Dakota is a dry farming state, so strips of land were left unplowed to hold moisture for coming seasons. Wells and irrigation ditches were built. The Ormond Dam near Belle Fourche helped turn dry prairie into rich farmland. And just about the time farmers were getting a handle on irrigation and dry farming techniques, it stopped raining. The drought of the dirty 30s was so hard on farmers that many upped and moved west. A lot of folks figured farming in South Dakota was over.
But there were other people in South Dakota who were not ready to give up. They could sense that the ecology was telling them to change the way they used the land. Dry farming and irrigation might not be enough. The winds of the Dust Bowl needed to be broken. The careful methods of dry farming needed to be expanded. We needed to be more conservation conscious.
In the years before World War II, South Dakotans had done much to repair the damage done to the ecology. Shelter belts slowed wind erosion. Stock dams held water for dry times. And the government created agencies like the Soil Conservation Service to help farmers learn the latest techniques. After World War II, there was another major change in our ecology. In 1944, Congress passed the Pick-Sloan Act, which authorized the construction of four huge dams along the Missouri. Changing the river's environment created opportunities for different kinds of fishing in South Dakota, but it also created problems. The once plentiful prehistoric paddlefish couldn't live in the new river. But steps were taken to save this rare species.
Well, here's that spot I was talking about when we started today's South Dakota adventure. This is a small stand of native grass by anyone's standards, but it's a very healthy one. Can you imagine everything from Sioux Falls to Pierre covered with lush, chest-high, deep grasses? Wow! This stand wouldn't be here if someone hadn't taken time to protect it. And there are other larger native stands that could be close enough to your school for a visit. Well, then you could know Big Blue Stem, Little Blue Stem, and Needle and Thread as your own personal connection with your environment. I guess that all of this has taught us that we need to make a more careful study of the environmental impact of the changes that we propose in the name of progress. Now, we can monitor these changes right here in the field, or we can put satellites high in the sky to watch the impact on the environment. Satellites high in the sky? That's our next South Dakota adventure.